Perhaps the name of the man in command would serve better? That seriously changed both the tenor of voice and the countenance, which, ruddy already, went a deeper shade of red, while the voice, with a strong hint of Yorkshire, was a rasp.
It do, sir, for it stinks. Imparted to me by the officer Admiral Vereker, sent up from Ramsgate. He was as shocked as I am myself at the name, that such a bastard should be given a ship, while honest men languish ashore as a disgrace.
Would it be one known outside the service? Was a gentle inquiry. Obviously Perkins saw himself as both honest and wronged.
Would that it were known to all, sir, that such a man should merit a command is an abomination. Hazard has been given to a misshapen creature by the name of John Pierce, who should be keel-hauled for his presumption of rank.
Why so? Much of what followed made no sense to Carruthers, who could not care a jot for the method by which naval officers achieved their rank, but he made a good fist of appearing interested, finally asking,
I've not satisfied my belly since early morning, Lieutenant. I trust you know of somewhere I can do so.
Indeed, sir, I can recommend the Admiral Benbow, which I myself use.
Would you care to join me? If not food, a pot of ale, perhaps?
I would go to a glass of rum, sir.
Then let it be my pleasure to provide it.
On his way to Portsmouth, Walter Hodgson was on an errand which had nothing to do with the search he was tasked to undertake on behalf of Edward Druce. Mind, it was to him the bill for the coach and accommodation would go, an act which would not trouble Hodgson's conscience at all. He'd said he would search the nation's seaports, and none was greater in such a regard than the premier base of the King's Navy. His interview with Emily Barclay had confirmed the cause of her problem to be Cornelius Gerson, so he was headed on her behalf for the location where this sod was living,